not just anybody.
Help!
You know I need someone.
Help!
When I was younger, so much younger than today,
I never needed
anybody's help in any way. Days are gone, I'm not so self-assured. Now I find a change of mind, I'll open up the doors.
Help me if you can, I'm feeling down, and I do appreciate you being around. Help me get my feet back on the ground. Won't you please, please help me?
Hi everybody, I'm Beatty Cone Fredos, and welcome again to the Ask Beatty Show. And isn't it the truth, my friends, that none of us are immune from life's challenges, whether or not we're talking about our relationships or mental health issues like depression or anxiety or bipolar disorder, or what about our sex lives? And we're not doing particularly well in the bedroom when it comes to looking at Americans' sexual behavior. And what about that substance abuse? You know that you're just popping too many pills, and I don't care whether or not they're pills that have been prescribed by your provider. You know, you're just taking too much medication, or you're drinking too much. And of course, the real question, you know, this is what I deal with in my private practice here in New York City and in East Hampton, and I've been practicing, and for those of you who've been listening to the Ask Beatty Show for the last number of years, it's now over 35 years, and I've learned a great deal from the people who I have treated. Hopefully, they've also learned a great deal from me. But when we are suffering, when we are on a merry-go-round or a roller coaster ride and not a fun ride, it always boils down to the question of what we are going to do about it. And as Gary Nell tells us all the time, a fear of knowing is a fear of doing. And unless we are committed to doing, we are going to continue on the same old cycle. You know, if you look at depression, I mean, there are 16 million adults in the United States who are suffering from depression. That's one in five Americans. 40 million adults are suffering from a variety of anxiety disorders. And it was interesting. There was a piece in the New York Times over the weekend. The headline was, "It's not just a chemical imbalance." And of course, I'm thinking, hopefully, after all these years, we realize that it is not just a chemical imbalance. So the writer, her name is Kelly Maria Corducci. And this is what she says. She says, as we know, the antidepressant Prozac came on the market in 1986. Do I ever remember the year? Listening to Prozac was written by Dr. Peter Kramer, who was actually a friend and a colleague of mine in Providence, Rhode Island. And by the time of the early 2000s, I mean, half a dozen other antidepressants belonging to the same class of drugs, selective serotonin reuptake inhibitors, or SSRIs, had joined in on the market. And the mainstreaming, and I think it's still very, very much the case today, particularly when people are visiting psychiatrists. So the mainstreaming of SSRIs and other psychopharmaceuticals really didn't eradicate the stigmas against mental illness, but it certainly, you know, what it actually did is that it normalized a sense of their presence. And a 2003 study concluded that child and adolescent psychotropic medication rates alone had nearly tripled since the late 1980s. And it really did. It shaped the tone of our conversations. So what were the conversations really like? Well, no longer were mental illnesses necessarily discussed as a shameful aberration, but rather as chemically preordained sicknesses, functions of what became known as chemical imbalance. And how often I would hear parents and I would hear people asking me the question, do I have a chemical imbalance? As if that was the only issue that was contributing to the person's anxiety or depression. And Kelly goes on to say that as a teenager entering the psychiatric care system, and what a system it is, she found this logic to be tremendously reassuring. She says that she came from an extended family of medical providers and had been raised to trust. Of course, we had all been raised to trust our doctors and to never, ever question, to question their diagnosis, to question their treatment plan. So she'd been raised to trust the hard scientific grounding of modern medicine. So internalizing, she says, my diagnosis as inscriptions of emotional destiny. After all, she was diagnosed with a chemical imbalance. It also alleviated, she said, my sense of personal blame for the inability to will away my black dogs. So she learned something, because she says nearly two decades later, I quake with anger. And she is absolutely right. And I also quake with anger at the wholesale failure of mental health care in America. A rigid rheology of mental illness argues that the tunnel vision of modern psychiatry, with its fixation on wiring and fixed diagnoses, cannot adequately address what has yet to be understood by the human psyche. Yes, my friends, there are people who do need medication. But I look at some of my own patients who I have begged and I have pleaded to please change their psychiatrist. And they are being prescribed so many different kinds of pills without having looked at their family and possible trauma and abuse and the social dynamics that we're living in right now. So psychiatrists, as we know, and there are good psychiatrists, I've yet here in New York actually to meet anybody that I feel comfortable referring my patients to. So that if you know anyone, if any of you right now are working with an MD psychiatrist who you know and you trust, please let me know. In fact, you can call me right now. The call-in number is 888-874-4888. But these days, many of them spend much less time than they did in the past practicing psychotherapy. I don't know how many psychiatrists that I know actually practice psychotherapy, or what we might call talk therapy. Instead, typically when you go to a psychiatrist, they tend to meet with patients briefly. Briefly can be less than an hour for an initial consultation, which is really disgusting, and write prescriptions. And as a result, psychiatry really has more or less become shorthand for an industry of medication management. And of course, the jury is out on the extent to which mental illness is hardwired, but black and white narratives of psychopathology neglect the tremendous psychological impacts of social and material circumstances, and access to the basics of survival, the burdens of intergenerational trauma and insufficient social support systems, the existential gut punch of pervasive injustice. And to be sure, Again, I want to stress the fact that it's not that nobody ever should be taking psychiatric medications, but to be sure, many people do need medication from time to time and greatly benefit from it. The right drugs can really make a difference, but mental health, my friends, is far, far more complicated than simply taking a pill. You know, I want to tell you about a couple of patients that I'm treating right now who have been so overly medicated, and I continue to try to convince them to please seek a second opinion, seek a third opinion. But this is a really interesting case history. This woman, and of course I'm going to be changing a lot of the identifying information, she's in her late 60s. She is bipolar. She does need to be on a mood stabilizer. She does not need to be on the 10 or 12 other psychiatric medications that her doctor has prescribed. And in fact, in this particular situation, I keep thinking I really ought to report him to the American Psychiatric Association. He hasn't seen her face to face in over 1 year, and yet he continues to prescribe. I see her a couple of times a week, and other than her sometimes being overdosed on the Valium that he also continues to prescribe, she basically is doing okay. However, physically, she has had, you know, you talk about the mind-body connection. Physically, she has had some very, very severe urological issues. And talk about my learning more about urology than I ever have in my entire life. So her initial urological problem, and you're probably wondering, why am I talking urology when I'm a psychotherapist and a sex therapist? But you will soon see the link between psychiatric medications and a lot of problems that can be triggered and can be caused because of, I would say, neglectful prescribing on the part of her psychiatrist. So her initial problem was urine retention. She's had surgery. She's had devices. She has learned how to cast. She casts about 5 to 6 times a day. And I've always asked her, do you think that any of these problems, and not being an MD, I'm not pretending to know anything about urology, do you think that any of these problems may have to do with your diet or with the multitude of medications that you are taking on a daily basis? No, no, she says. She sees her internist, and of course, does anybody ask about how many pills she's actually taking? Do any of the doctors question what her diet is, all the sugar that she is consuming on a daily basis? No. Nobody, of course, asks those questions. I ask those questions, but I am not in a position to be able to say that the diet and all of the medication is responsible for your urology problems. So that was urology problem number one. Then she ends up in the hospital a couple of weeks ago with severe constipation. Again, I know absolutely nothing about urine retention, although I certainly become a pretty good pupil. She's taught me a lot about these issues. And so she's discharged from the hospital, and she is sent to, and this is a doctor, a specialty that I had never even heard of, to a motility specialist. So a motility specialist is somebody that is really able to take a very, very in-depth look at what is going on urologically. I mean, I would have thought over the years, because she has seen other urologists, she has seen gynecologists. I mean, this has been going on for years and years, but fortunately, after her hospitalization, she is referred to this motility specialist. So what do you think this motility specialist told her? What this woman said was that all of your medications, all of the medications have been contributing over a long, long time to both the urine retention problem and also to the constipation problem. And she, of course, was questioning her about her diet. Now, this woman, so I asked her, I said, so listen, now you really have it from an expert. She'd been waiting to see this woman for quite some time. This woman is considered to be the expert, the motility expert here in New York City. So now I think that my job is going to be to continue to try to convince my patient to get a second opinion from a new psychiatrist and see what of the 10 various pills perhaps could be eliminated. Maybe the doses could be changed. Maybe the family of medications could be changed. So here we have it. And who would have thought? I think Gary Null probably would have thought this and made the correlation and begun to look at the relationship between, here we have the urological issues and all of the psych medication that has been prescribed to her. So lessons to be learned. And then I want to tell you about another patient of mine who sustained incredible, incredible trauma when she was a child growing up. Physical abuse, verbal abuse, sexual abuse, and emotional abuse. She's an absolutely amazing woman, in and out of hospitals, in and out of rehab facilities. And I've been working with her now for a couple of years, and terrible, terrible relationships with men. And yes, she's read my book, For Better, For Worse, Forever, Discover the Path to Lasting Love, which of course teaches people how to assess who's right for you and who's wrong for you before you commit. But of course, before we can do really accurate assessments, we have to get our own lives together and emotionally work through as best as we can the traumas of the past, the traumas of the present, what happened, what did not happen in our early childhood and in our life. And this old unfinished business, and what I call the skeletons of the closet, I really wish I could be at this microphone right now and tell you that none of that is important at all, that cognitive behavioral therapy is the way to do it, that you don't have to deal with the old issues, and that all you have to do is be mindful, which of course is important, and change your mindset and change your current behavior, and all will be well. However, that's not true. It's absolutely not true. And if there was a way, because I am such a bottom line person, and people who know me personally and people who have worked with me know that I am a very pragmatic person. So if something works, great. And if it doesn't work, that us just toss it from the treatment plan. So dealing emotionally with the old issues, the unfinished business, the skeletons in the closet, the abuse of various different kinds, the sexual abuse, the sexual assault, the verbal, the physical, the emotional abuse, there is a way to do this even though we cannot change our history. And to pretend that we can just fast forward our lives without attempting as best as we can to emotionally process all of this, where it leaves us is that we always, always tend to have one foot in the past and one foot in the present. So this was something that this patient, she started to do with her various therapies and the rehabs and the hospitalizations, but she had a lot more work to do. And I think probably for her, the number one challenge was assessing and eliminating as quickly as possible toxic people and toxic situations, including her mother and many, many members of her family. And no sooner that she started to engage with the toxicity, the depression and the anxiety that was starting, it was starting to get better, she would have a relapse. So fast forward, it's December of 2018, and this woman is in really, really bad, bad shape. I'm seeing her 2 to 3 times a week. She has access to my cell phone. She texts, she calls, she emails. In fact, you know, times have been so tough for her that she will even be in the middle of the night talking with somebody at the suicide hotlines. And thank goodness for the 24-hour suicide hotlines that do exist in this country. So the real question, and medication for her has not been helpful, even though she clearly, clearly at that point was severely, severely clinically depressed. She was talking about suicide. And the question really was what to do. And I was of two minds. I felt on the one hand, she probably needed to be in the hospital. I mean, there were only so many times a week that I could continue to see her. But the depression was not. It was simply not easing up. So she comes in to my office for her therapy session. And she's lonely, and she's really tired of all these toxic, disgusting, dysfunctional relationships that she has found herself in, and of course that she has chosen. She has chosen. And so it was Christmas, and when you think about Christmas and Hanukkah, you want to be with family, you want a connection, you want a partner. At least this woman really, really wanted a relationship, and for her, the most important thing in life, and it is for me as well, and I thank God for my marriage to Jim every single day, because it does, it really does make a huge difference. So we were sitting, and maybe there was a light moment during the session. And I said, you know, I said, why don't you get back on Match.com? She says, I've been on all the dating sites, and there's no good men in New York, and I just have given up. And I said, look, I said, what do you have to lose? I said, you're very depressed. You really still want a relationship. You're a young woman. You're 58 years of age. What do you have to lose by giving it a shot? So I took out my phone. I took a really, really terrific picture of her. And during the session, we posted it on Match.com. So what do you think happened? A week goes by, and she gets a response from a man who lives in New Jersey. And on the surface, he did not appear to meet all of her criteria. He wasn't tall enough. He wasn't rich enough, although it's turned out that he is really very quite wealthy. And she was going to just not respond. And I said to her, I said, look, I said, at least you can email him. And what do you have to lose by meeting him and having a cup of coffee or going for a walk? So she's very depressed. She's very resistant. But she decided to take my advice, and they met. And it's been a beautiful, beautiful story. They've been together now for just a little over 7 months. He sounds to be terrific. I have yet to meet him. So when you look at her diagnosis at Christmas, it was severe, severe clinical depression. I would say suicidal depression. But if you looked more closely at what it was that this woman really needed, she needed a relationship. She needed something that was healthy and constructive and respectful and loving. And loneliness has become, from all the studies that I have read, the number one epidemic in the world. People are lonely, even though people are on their phones and people are on the computer. People are lonely. And have all of her issues been worked through? Of course they have not. But, you know, she'll text me pictures, and they go dancing, and they go to concerts. And for the first time in her life, and it actually is the first time in her life, she is in a healthy relationship with a man. Yes, I continue to see her a couple of times a week. Yes, there's still ups and downs when it comes to you know, when it comes to her mood. But, you know, when I look at studies, you know, when I'm looking in front of me at an article, and I talk about this article a lot, and this is the 80-year Harvard study that says that the one thing in our life that will make you happier and healthier. And of course, those of you who've been listening to the Ask Beatty Show for all of this time, you know what the answer is. And the answer is healthy relationships. The money doesn't do it. It does it for the day. It does it for the day. And you can go to an expensive hotel and you can buy designer clothes and jewelry and go on fancy trips and have your own private plane. But in the final analysis, the most comprehensive study of well-being in history reveals the single message that comes through loudly and clearly. So Dr. Robert Waldinger, he's a psychiatrist, and he sounds like a really, really good guy. I wish that he were in New York. And he is currently directing the Harvard study of adult development, one of the most comprehensive studies of emotional well-being in history. Well, it is about time that we were looking at emotional well-being. So the study, this is interesting. It began in 1938 during the Great Depression and counted President John F. Kennedy and longtime Washington Post editor Ben Bradley as the original subjects. And I did not do this. I did not learn this, and I did not read this carefully. So what did Waldinger have to say when asked to present his conclusions on this unprecedented study? So he cited one message that came through loud and clear. Good relationships keep us happier and healthier, period. So when we gather together everything that we knew, okay, about these participants at age 50. So he's looking. This is a longitudinal study. So it wasn't their middle age cholesterol levels. Of course, we know it's important to have a really healthy diet that predicted how they were going to grow old. It was how satisfied they were in their relationships. And the people who were the most satisfied in their relationships at age 50 were the healthiest at age 80. So good relationships don't just protect our bodies and our emotionality. They protect our brains. All right. So how can you cultivate? How can we cultivate better relationships? Well, communicate. Building trust requires constant communication, not just texts, all right, which allows you to stay in touch with one another, person's reality. You become quickly aware of their highs and lows and how you deal with them. Be authentic. You know, not just, oh, yes, everything is fine. Aren't you cool? We just love being around you when you really can't stand being around the people. Being authentic. Authentic people share their true thoughts and feelings with others. They understand that they aren't perfect, but they're willing to show those imperfections because they know everyone else has them too. And by accepting others for who they are, authentic and individuals prove relatable. Of course, that is assuming, okay, that the people are healthy and that they are not toxic and that they do not make you crazy, because those kinds of people, regardless of how authentic they are, those kinds of people we do not need in our lives. And authenticity, it doesn't mean sharing everything about yourself with everyone all of the time. it does mean saying what you mean and meaning what you say and sticking to your values and principles above all else. So you really have to be who you are, and then you're going to see who you're really going to be able to connect with. But you're only going to find that out is if you're really true to yourself. And then he talks about being helpful. One of the easiest ways to gain someone's trust is to help them. And it's often the small things that matter the most. An offer to make a cup of coffee, pitching in with the dishes or helping to carry in groceries, offering a helping hand whenever possible. And actions like these, you know, assuming that you don't have a hidden agenda or another agenda, these kinds of actions really do inspire trust. And be honest. How honest are we most of the time? Do we just say things, or are we really being authentic and really being honest? Because honest communication is more than saying what you sincerely believe. It means avoiding half-truths and trying your best to represent yourself in a way that's clear and forthright. Of course, how we do this is also very important. How to say it and where to say it, whatever it is that you're needing to say, and when to say it is also very, very critical. And how to do all of this well. Haven't you found yourself, because I certainly have many, many times over the years, in a situation where there's something that I really need to say, and yet I know it's going to be a very dicey communication with the person. And what I'll do is I'll kind of practice, and I will practice out loud, just trying to express myself well, while at the same time being really honest with my message, not avoiding or denying or just pretending that all is well when things are not at all well. And of course, making a date to be able to have really honest conversations. And I suggest that people do not do this when they're running out of the house in the morning or before they are going to sleep. And also, dependability. We live in an age of commitment breaking. You know, let's get together, and then at the last minute, you know, something else comes up, or you decide that you really don't want to do it, and that does not build good relationships. And it's common, it's so common, and I think more and more now, for people to back out of an agreement or plan whenever they feel like it. In contrast, those who focus on staying true to their word develop a reputation for reliability and trustworthiness, so that if you don't want to get together with someone, don't say that you do and then at the last moment break the date. You know, find the way, even though it may be a little bit difficult, to say, listen, I would rather not. I would rather not go to your fundraiser. I would rather not get together. I'm peopled out. I'm tired. But to be honest and to be authentic, and then you're going to find out, you know, who your friends really are and aren't. Because in good friendships, we're not always going to agree. We are not always going to be available. But it's the honesty and the authenticity that really does make a difference. And in addition, building self-awareness and self-control can help you avoid making commitments to which you have no intentions of sticking. And I think that I'm somewhat guilty of that socially from time to time. The idea of going to the party, or the idea of going to the fundraiser or the meeting or the networking group, it sounds very, very exciting. And then when I think about it more, I really decide that it is not exactly what I want to do. But I think you know, it's okay to change your mind because you've thought about it more carefully. But even in changing your mind to say, look, you know, I've really overbooked myself and I really love what you're doing and I support your organization, but I probably should not have said yes because I had a sense that this was not something that I really wanted to do. Showing appreciation. We're talking about the things that we all need to do if we are going to have healthy relationships. And it's not just healthy romantic relationships. It's healthy relationships across the board. Show appreciation. How often do you tell people in your life, whether or not they're coworkers, whether or not they're lovers, partners, friends, bosses, hey, I really appreciate what you're doing. I really, really am grateful for the fact that you've been so helpful or so nice, because everybody wants to be appreciated for what they do, and why not give it to them? You know, I was talking to a Via driver. Jim and I, we take a lot of Vias, and I always ask the driver, I want to know what they feel about the passengers. And invariably, the drivers will tell me it's a 50-50 split. So, of course, I want to know, you know, the 50% of the people who they are not crazy about driving around town, what is it? What is it about them that is upsetting to the drivers? And invariably, they all tell me that it is a lack of appreciation, that people don't say thank you. In fact, yesterday I was buying some salad, and it was a very long line at the salad bar, and I was getting ready to pay. And I asked this young man the same question. I said, listen, it's a very busy place. You've got great salads. I want to know, what are the people like? And this was a restaurant on the Upper West Side in New York City. And they have great, great salads. And he looked at me and it was as if he was asking me, is it really okay? Is it cool to be honest with you? I said, listen, I really want to know. I want to know what you think about the customers. He said exactly the same thing. He said, what's really upsetting to me is that people don't thank us. You know, we make the salads, we do the best that we can. So this little word of thank you, it means so much. And of course, I think that we feel better too if we realize that we are showing appreciation to others. And it's not enough, by the way, to feel appreciation. You have to show it. Otherwise, they may not know. So think about all the people in your life today and think about who should you right now maybe call or text or email or walk up over to and say, listen, I want to thank you. I really appreciate your goodness, your kindness, your help, because it makes all the difference in the world. And when you tell others specifically what you value about them and why you encourage them to continue doing the things that make them great, and maybe even more importantly, you foster positive feelings and draw closer to you and encourage them to be appreciative too. Little things, but so, so very important if we're really serious, about building great, great relationships. Showing empathy. Empathy has been described as the ability to feel another person's pain in your heart. So to display empathy, it's not necessary to have gone down the same road to share the same experiences or circumstances as others. Rather, you must simply strive to understand the person by getting to know their perspective. You know, tell me more about this. I haven't lived your life, but I really want to understand what it is that you're feeling, why it is that you're having such a difficult time, or why it is that you're having such a joyful time. And this is easier said than done, because the key is not to judge or minimize the feelings of the other person or to give the other person advice. But if they're struggling with something that you feel is not a big deal from your perspective, try to remember a time when you struggled and what would have helped at that point in time to have made you feel better. And if you can truly empathize with another person, they will feel understood and will likely be moved to reciprocate the effort the next time you're in need. So we all need to slow down a little bit. And if somebody is saying, you know, I've had a really, really difficult day, rather than saying, oh, well, other people have many more difficult days than you, so why don't you just, you know, suck it up and go for a walk or go to the gym or have a cup of coffee, to be able to say to them, look, I haven't walked in your shoes, but tell me about it, and I'm sorry that you're having a tough time, and is there anything at all right now that I might be able to do to help you to feel better? Now, maybe there's nothing you can do at all, but saying it, communicating it in that way, it's very powerful, and it really makes a difference. Again, if you are serious about wanting to build healthy relationships. And finally, Dr. Waldinger, he talks about the importance of apologizing, not cheap apologizing, but serious apologizing, because there are going to be times in our life when you feel like there is anything in the world that you would rather not do than say, I am sorry. And yet those two words, they have the potential to change another person's, and yours as well, entire demeanor or mood, to heal hurt feelings and to show that you truly value your relationship. You know, that was one of the things about Joe Biden. He, and there was an article that was written, and people were very upset, and I was actually very, very upset about the fact that he was not able to apologize for what happened during the Anita Hill, crisis that really happened so many years ago. And I think that there was a basic sense of decency to say, you know, maybe I didn't handle this in the best possible way. Because after all, politicians are people and they do make mistakes. In fact, they make lots of mistakes. But people should be allowed to evolve. But first, they have to say that they are sorry. And that was the thing that was on the news, and people were talking a lot about the fact that Joe Biden, for whatever reason, because maybe he thought it was going to do something to his credibility, and I think that it would have done a lot of positive things to his credibility to be able to say that years ago I behaved in a certain way, and if I had an opportunity, if I had an opportunity today, I would have responded differently, and I am sorry. And I think that saying that I'm sorry, it's a very important thing, because we all make mistakes, and every meaningful conversation that you have, every authentic and helpful act, every honest word, every promise you keep, every word of sincere and specific appreciation, and even apology, will contribute to build deep and trusting relationships like the untold number of delicate brushstrokes that make up a beautiful painting. And as Dr. Robert Waldinger has said, that the research proves that those relationships, those healthy relationships, will keep you happier and healthier, period. So every week, you know, I ask you to take a long, hard look at how you are doing in your relationships. If you happen to be married, or if you happen to be in a romantic relationship, I think people have to understand that we all go through lots and lots and lots of ups and downs. It's normal. It's okay. But again, the real question is that when we run into difficulties in our relationship with our boss, with our colleagues, with our lovers, with our spouses, with our children, are we willing to acknowledge and address and resolve our issues as best as we possibly can? And that's the thing that when people have asked me over the years, when I'm interviewed on radio and television, and they'll ask me, what do I really think are the two most important ingredients that make or break relationships? Of course, chemistry is important, and we all want to have great sexual relationships, and we want to be financially in a good place. But the bottom line is this, is that emotional communication and emotional problem solving, those are the skills. Those are the ingredients that really make or break relationships. And if we are lacking, and all of us at times are lacking when it comes to being effective communicators and effective problem solvers, then we need to actually do something about it. And some short-term counseling, some courses, some books, it can really make all the difference in the world, because unfortunately we are not schooled. We're not schooled at school, and we're oftentimes not schooled in our own family of origins. And, you know, where do we learn these things if we don't learn it in our family and we don't learn it at school? We're really left to our own devices to figure this all out, to figure out how to be an effective communicator and problem solver, to figure out how to have a successful and healthy relationship. There are so many things. There's so many really, really important things that get very, very little attention. These days, you know, when you look at what is important, what do people really value? I mean, people talk about relationships, but what do we hear about? We hear about corporations. We hear about the bottom line. We hear about money. We hear about bigger, better, more. We don't hear a lot about the things that really do make a difference in our lives. But you have, that's the point. You have the power, and you have the opportunity when you're seeing that there's certain things in your life that are just off course. You have the ability, and I have the confidence in you, especially people who've been listening to the show now for the last several years, to take the necessary steps to turn your life around, whether we're not talking about mental health issues, whether we're talking about substance abuse, whether we're talking about relationships, whether we're talking about sexuality. You know, you can. I mean, we can complain and we can moan about how things are not working out and the kinds of families that we came from, and that patriarchy is responsible for all the problems in the world. And of course, we have real problems with patriarchy and misogyny and the Trumps of the world. But invariably, despite the fact that all of those things are true, We still, and I think that there are some people that may disagree with me on this, but I feel that we still have a personal responsibility to do what we need to do to get our lives on track as best as we possibly can. I mean, if we're talking about, you know, lifestyle issues, and this is something that, you know, Gary Null talks about every single day. We know the things that we need to do to keep us healthy. We know that we should have a plant-based diet. We know that we should eliminate sugars and alcohol as best as we can. And I will hear so many people say, yes, we know that, but, you know, it's I crave the donuts. I want to have, you know, some alcohol from time to time. And we end up really self-sabotaging ourselves and, at worst, really engaging in destructive and self-destructive behavior. We know that exercise is important. We know that weight training and yoga and meditation are important. And yet, so many people, there are a million different reasons that we can have for not doing what is in our best interest. We know the importance of eliminating toxins in our life, chemicals in our life. We need to be mindful about these kinds of things. We also know about the importance of eliminating toxic people in our lives. And of course, that can be a lot more challenging. And of course, that includes, you know, friends and family. So, you know, when people leave my office after their sessions, and I think you've heard me say this a number of different times, I ask them to consider two things, two basic things as they go through their days every single day, and to be mindful of these things. And I'm going to ask you to do exactly the same thing. I want you to ask yourself as you're navigating your days, whether or not whatever it is that you're doing, whether it's work, whether it's engaging in social situations, whether it's your relationship, whether or not whatever it is that you're doing is really in your best interest. Is it good for you? Is it nurturing for you? Is it positive? Is it supportive? Is it something that is really going to bring you joy and happiness, and that it is in sync with your values of how you want to be living your life? And sometimes people have to really think about this. Is this good for me or is this bad for me? But that is exactly what I want you to contemplate, because so often, if we are not mindful of our behavior, if we are not mindful of what we are doing and who we are interacting with and who we are communicating with, we end up doing a lot of things that are really not in our best interest at all. So there needs to be, first of all, there really needs to be an awareness on a day-to-day basis. Am I living a good life? Am I living a healthy life? Am I living a life that really resonates with who I am? Or am I living my life as an imposter? You know, other things that are really important, positive visualization, listening to music and dancing and aromatherapy. And sometimes if you don't have anybody to talk to and you have a lot of feelings that you've internalized, journaling can really, really help you get out some of the feelings that you've just not really been able to express. Eliminating sugars and sodas and alcohol and nicotine, being mindful of what you are putting into your body. And these days, you know, I take the subway to the Progressive Radio Network every Monday. And I look around and everybody is on their cell phones and they're playing games and they're emailing and they're on their computers. And my advice, and I think that a lot of people would really agree, is to try to find a way to minimize the social media and the cell phones and the computer and take a walk and enjoy nature and talk to people face to face where you can have some physical contact, where you're looking people in the eye and not just on Skype. And I think basically what we have to do is to find a better way to find a balance between work and how we want to live, and to try to have as much fun as we possibly can. Because Gary Nell talks about intentional ignorance and intentional neglect, right? We know what's good for us, I think, if we really, you know, take some time and think about it, and we know what is not. So we need to be very, very mindful of doing what is in our best interest as we go throughout our day. So hopefully you are going to take this all in. And hard to believe that I have so many other articles that I wanted to go through with you, but we will do that next week. And I want to leave you with my two weekly messages, very important messages. And of course, the first one is that I want you to do everything that you possibly can do to find a way to love yourself, to do what is in your best interest, and to figure that out. And then, of course, secondly, and it's so important, particularly in these crazy political times, that we all need to do a much, much better job in finding ways to love each other. So have a very, very good rest of the day. It's hot, hot, hot and humid here in beautiful New York City. But enjoy the rest of the day, and I will talk with you next week. So take care, everybody. Bye-bye. What the world?